This video is sponsored by Skillshare. The first 1,000 people who use the link in my description will receive a 1-month free trial to Skillshare Premium. Stick around to the end to learn more. In its original form, synth-pop looked towards the future, musicians making a guess at what the 21st century would sound like. But in the 2010s, music at large just wanted to recycle what had happened 40 years ago. In bringing a forward-thinking approach to dance pop, UK producer SOPHIE was different. Unwilling to follow the constraints of old and obsessed with the purest of pop, SOPHIE's bouncing metallic second single laid the groundwork for Bubblegum Bass, Hyperpop, and some of the most inventive chart pop production in recent memory. But was the world ready for the future of pop? This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Bipp. SOPHIE's early life is clouded with mystery, by design. The information we do know is limited. SOPHIE grew up in Glasgow, Scotland, was taken to raves at an early age by father, and so obsessed by this thumping, euphoric music, SOPHIE intended to drop out of school and become an electronic music producer at the age of 10, a request denied by parents. While this lack of information adds to the enigma of SOPHIE, it was also SOPHIE's belief that these background details were irrelevant to what was really important, the music. The music is not about where someone grew up or what they looked like against a wall. Therefore, you should try to use every opportunity available to say what you're trying to say. Instead of saying, here's my music and this is what I look like, nobody cares. After a stint in Berlin electronic band Motherland in the late 2000s, SOPHIE started appearing on most people's radars as an associate of eccentric London-based music collective slash label PC Music. Around 2013. With a similar worldview to PC Music founder A.G. Cook, the both of them began creating their own peculiar form of electronic music. I emailed SOPHIE and it was very much like, wow, no one else in London is doing this kind of music. Everyone else was in this quite serious, bassy UK club scene, and we were both into pop music. So I realised I wasn't alone. That was a real excitement for me. What PC Music and SOPHIE were creating was a maximalist form of chart pop, the most sugary of bubblegum, taking studio production to its most extreme. To be both experimental and accessible. A hyperpop, if you will. Though aesthetically similar, their methods differed. Cook's productions would layer countless chords of the most default MIDI instruments to create his gigantic hooks. Whereas SOPHIE was more into sound design, using the Electron mono machine to filter and augment synthesized audio to recreate real-world sounds and textures. For example, SOPHIE was one to obsess over the way a bubble has an ascending pitch when popped. My primary concern is, what's the most sonically exciting thing I can imagine? Then I try to make that. Following the release of the sparkling club dance of Nothing More to Say in February 2013, SOPHIE would become the talk of the hype machine after Bipp was released onto SoundCloud 4 months later via dance label Numbers. At the time, it was met with violent confusion. What was this? Its bubblegum synths called to mind the sonics of Eurodance. You gotta be crazy. While the evil sounding sub-low bass bears similarity with Esky Beat or Grime. An oh-so-cute coating with a brutally gruesome undercurrent. Though some might have been able to hear it as an offshoot of house or dubstep, Bipp lacks a kick drum, dance music's key ingredient. The language of electronic music shouldn't still be referencing obsolete instruments like kick drum or clap. No one's kicking or clapping. They don't have to. other listeners chance comparisons to Numbers label mate Rusty. Or J-pop idol Kiri Pamu Pamu. SOPHIE appeared briefly on Radio 1 to talk to dubstep producer Scream.
Tell us about your track, Bipp, and tell us what genre you would like to call it.
It's dance pop music, just like everything else. That's the only type of music that exists. And anyone that says anything else is a liar.
What's going on with your voice?
I've got a cough.
For the longest time, no one was even sure who was singing on the track. Many believing that the ultra-affected vocal was SOPHIE, or maybe even a sample. It turned out that Bipp's source vocals were performed by SOPHIE's former bandmate, Marcella Dizvi. But additionally, Dizvi's vocals were so pitched up, chopped and skewed, they were more an extra sonic texture than the focus. What was just as striking was how the synths sounded like a rubber ball, bouncing within a reverbless void. No doubt an effect of its monophonic mix. Bipp coming at you between your standard stereo channels. Unlike a lot of the other components of the UK club scene at the time, Bipp was not backward-facing nostalgia, but in fact music that sounded brand new, like the future. While its lyric, as altered and synthetic as it was, reassured that everything could be okay. Though listeners disagreed over its origins, one thing they agreed on was that Bipp sounded like nothing else released in 2013. Though it didn't come close to charting, the underground tastemakers and music press took notice. Most would dismiss the track as a funny sounding oddity, but some did see what SOPHIE was trying to achieve, and applauded loudly. As such, Pitchfork and XL Rater placed Bipp high on the end of year track lists. Through 2014, SOPHIE would continue with the release of Lemonade,
Lemonade.
And Hard. To similarly split reactions. The people who got it loved it. But if SOPHIE wanted to expose this vision of future pop to the widest possible audience, a pop star with some chart experience would be required. Let's ride. Let's ride. In 2014, SOPHIE had toyed with producing a pop star. QT was a PC music concoction, with the face of American performer Hayden Dunham and the voice of Harriet Pittard. It was pop in more ways than one, as the project's sole single seemed to be in part an advertisement for a then unavailable carbonated drink, also called QT. With Hey QT, due to its quirky, sugary, extreme pop style, and based on the producer's previous work, the music press weren't sure whether it was supposed to be taken seriously or merely as an act of pop satire, a debate that SOPHIE would be rackled by. Why would you bother investing so much of your time and energy in something that's basically laughing at something and not contributing anything? I don't think that's a worthwhile use of your time. But the work on Hey QT got the attention of Madonna, leading to SOPHIE working on the verses of her comeback single. Becoming the first SOPHIE-produced track to chart on the Hot 100. While working with the queen of 80s pop was a childhood dream, it ended up being somewhat mercenary, but SOPHIE's next collaboration would yield a co-conspirator in future pop. British artist Charlie XCX already existed within the pop sphere, initially coming to mainstream attention, co-writing and featuring on Iconopop's massive 2013 hit, I Love It. Guesting on Iggy Azalea's Fancy. I'm so fancy, you already know. Which Charlie also had a hand in writing, got a name attached to a further smash. In time for the bratty electropop of her breakthrough second album, 2014's Sucker. securing her a couple of radio hits in Break the Rules. And Boom Clap. Though she'd grown up wanting to be a massive pop star, comparable to Britney Spears or the Spice Girls, her brush with chart commerciality felt personally hollow, and already she was bored with the glossy punk-popish direction that her music was moving toward.
I've been over Sucker since we released it, but it's fine. I'm not like, oh god, I hate this. But I always want to move on to the next thing. I want to continue creating.
Since she had started making music and uploading it onto MySpace in the late 2000s, Charlie had been inspired by French club acts like Justice and Uffy.
I'm ready to fuck. I'm ready to fuck.
But not quite achieved the abrasive electronic sound for herself. After sending off a speculative email to Sophie, in July 2015, they started working on what would become the Vroom Vroom EP.
London Lamborghini gets out on the right side. Should've stayed at home because my girl wanted to ride.
I felt like I finally found someone who could articulate my ideas sonically. I felt like I'd been trying to make a song that sounded like Vroom Vroom forever, but I couldn't do it because I hadn't met anybody who had the skills to make the sound.
All my life, I've been waiting for a good time.
When I met Sophie, it was like, wow, you get it, and you get me, and you also make me feel something.
Whereas before, Charlie was writing music with the charts in mind, Vroom Vroom was aimed at the club, going just as hard as anything by Uffy.
Let's ride. Let's ride.
Sophie synthesized revs and beeps, signalling the arrival of the new Charlie XCX and the start of the party.
Vroom was like an assault. Vroom was not us trying to appease anyone. I think my label got afraid, and I think a lot of people were confused. But I just felt that I wanted to. I just wanted to do that. That's the scene I came from when I was younger, that club scene. That's originally what I saw in Sophie, and I'd never actually made music that was representative of that.
Inspired by working with will.i.am, Charlie had begun writing in a top-line first manner, making sure that her lyrics were to the point, the pure essence of the idea, so the choruses could hit super hard.
Bitches know they can't catch me. Cute, sexy, and my ride sporty.
But this meant that, despite Sophie's dynamic production, Charlie's new songs seemed to be almost too simple, many critics writing Vroom Vroom off as throwaway. Said Laura Snapes for Pitchfork, "No one is being done any favours by reducing Charlie XCX to a vapid cipher, particularly as it drains her vivid personality from the work." But not everyone can understand the future from the present, and Snapes has since retracted her comments. Released in February 2016, Vroom Vroom didn't chart, but gave Charlie a new identity, one she'd been secretly striving for years. Well, Sophie found an ally with whom to create this new form of hyperized pop music. Alongside working with Charlie XCX, for the next few years, Sophie would continue to collaborate with a far-reaching array of other artists, applying Sophie brand, technique, invention, and talent to Let's Eat Grandma, Lady Lesher, Arca, Kim Petras, FKA Twigs, and Vince Staples.
Boy, yeah, right, yeah, right, yeah, right.
Boy, yeah, right.
Sophie was different. You ain't never seen somebody in the studio smoking a cigarette, in a leather bubble jacket, just making beats, not saying one word. Aside from the product compilation of early singles, 5 years after Bipp, Sophie was yet to release a debut album. By mid-2017, many had heard Sophie's music, but few knew Sophie's identity. Some blurry candid photos taken at rare DJ sets aside, Sophie had not been physically introduced to the world. And again, this was by design, the Enigma producer being a familiar trope in electronica. One time Sophie even employed a friend to take the place behind the mixer at a live show, while the real Sophie looked on from the crowd. But on the 19th of October 2017, Sophie posted a music video for the first time, for the song It's Okay to Cry. At the same time, revealing Sophie's transfeminine identity.
Oh, hi. Was that a teardrop in your eye?
I think it's kind of ridiculous that you need to do a video that's a close-up, crying in the rain, for people to know that you're a real person. The song itself relies on 80s R&B ballad synths. And is by far the most traditional pop song that Sophie had released thus far. Unlike on other previous tracks, the voice on It's Okay to Cry is Sophie. All of the big occasions you might have missed, no, I accept you. Though affected in the artist's usual mode, you can still hear the little cracks and imperfections, showing a beating heart and raw emotion in spite of the synthetic pop rapping, the constant duality of Sophie's work. I'm always trying to encapsulate how we, as emotional beings, interact with the world and the machines and technology around us, being able to emote through these things. They're not antithetical or mutually exclusive. The song's lyrics communicate loving acceptance of a friend revealing a secret. Though could just as easily be Sophie talking to a former self. I hope you don't take this the wrong way, but I think your inside is your best side. Diving into the back catalogue, Sophie had always hinted at gender fluidity. For example, on Hard, Girlfriend of the Year's feminine voicing of the words But Sophie's transness was discussed further within It's Okay to Cry's parent album, Oil of Every Pearl's Uninsides, alongside the freeing club chant of Immaterial, and the futuristic dreaming of Whole New World, Pretend World. Is the distorted metal of face shopping. Amidst the industrial snorts, whirs, and crashes are the repeated words. I'm real when I shut my face. In a similar way that Sophie feels most comfortable when photoshopping pictures of herself to create this idealized version of the artist. To pass as cis, Sophie is doing the same thing with the vocals throughout Oil of Every Pearl's Uninsides, pitching them up to a more traditionally feminine frequency, lessening the dysphoria experienced when a trans person hears their voice back. A voice that sometimes does not feel like themselves. For me, transness is taking control to bring your body more in line with your soul and spirit, so the two aren't fighting against each other and struggling to survive. Oil of Every Pearl's Uninsides would be highly acclaimed upon release. The critics hailed the continued evolution of sound compared to Sophie's initial singles. It would be nominated for a Grammy for Best Dance Electronic Album in 2019, losing out to Justice. Sophie was on an upwards trajectory, teasing album number 2 in interviews, with a collaboration with Lady Gaga on the horizon. But early in the morning of the 30th of January 2021, in Athens, Greece, while attempting to get a better look at the full moon, Sophie accidentally fell from a third-story balcony, dying in hospital later that same day. Sophie was 34. In just under a decade since the release of Bipp, Sophie has amassed a considerable influence on the electronic and pop communities. Alongside PC Music, Sophie was a founding figure in Hyperpop, influencing 100 Gex, Dorian Electra, Slater, Rico Nasty, Rina Sawayama, not to mention the dozens of artists Sophie collaborated with, and the countless other underground and up-and-coming TikTok-centric artists composing within Sophie's template. Also, Sophie's visibility as a trans person within Hyperpop has made other trans people feel accepted in the genre and motivated them to make their own music, said Laura Les of 100 Gex. It's impossible to overstate the influence Sophie had on me and countless others, musically and otherwise. We're still going to be catching up to Sophie for years to come. Even legendary electronic duo Arteca, a formative influence on the artist, could hear Sophie's greatness. In the press release for compilation Product, Sophie had mentioned that there were to be no remixes of the songs, but with the addendum, unless it's Arteca. In mid-January 2021, the duo came through and via Sophie's previous label Numbers, released a stripped back version of Bipp with the note, "Sorry this is so late. Hope it's still of some use. SOPHIE's version of Bipp is now often seen as one of the defining and greatest tracks of the 2010s. While Oil of Every Pearl's Uninside's vulnerability and openness has been a comfort to so very many. Though thousands of bedroom artists have been inspired by SOPHIE to make music, most copy the artist in form rather than philosophy. Many ape the pitch vocals, the bubblegum synths, the hyperpop choruses, but few truly strive to stretch the limits of dance pop as SOPHIE did. As SOPHIE would bring up frequently in interviews, why try to replicate the sound of some artists from the past? The past has been done. SOPHIE forever sought to create the sounds of the future, to not be tied down to restrictive notions of the past. SOPHIE showed that the future of pop music could go way beyond mere 80s nostalgia, and furthermore, that you could be anything you wanted to be. The future could be better if you let it be. What are you doing right now? How long have you been watching YouTube today? Have you learnt anything new? If not, then Skillshare may be the service for you. Skillshare is an online learning community for anyone who wants to learn something new, where millions have come together to take the next step in their creative journey. This month I watched Creative Cooking, Simple Sauces to Elevate Every Meal. In it, Khalees of Milkshake fame shows you how to tell your story through food. But maybe you have no use for narrative food. You just want to draw yourself as a cartoon. With Charlie Clemens, Fun With Faces, create a stylized digital portrait. Skillshare has that covered too. Today is the perfect time to do that thing you always wanted to do. The first 1,000 people who use the link in my description receive a 1-month free trial to Skillshare Premium. So click that link, acquire a new skill, and become a better you. Thanks for watching. If you liked it, comment, like, subscribe, and hit that bell. I'd like to thank Eurofug4000 for providing the voice of Charlie XCX. Eurofug is a video game essayist with a particular interest in theme and atmosphere, and you should totally check out her most recent video on what makes Minecraft the perfect cottagecore game. Don't know what cottagecore is? Watch the video. It's linked right there. Shoutouts also to August's new top tier patrons, Ashley Whiteside, Ionis Psychos, and Tree Dude. Thanks, and I'll see you again in 2 weeks for a before genre video. See you then.